I think most of these groups would be vastly improved by sudden death.
I think they're sickening and disgusting.
They were great. They were great. If I could only make out the words, they'd be greater.
And just remember at one point him sitting on the bar and he was just covered in blood.
People in the audience would look at him horrified. What kind of person would do this?
We weren't the nice boys they thought we were. We aren't nice boys. We were.
She cared about him a lot and took care of him when she could, like a mother. But she was considered one of the gang.
We beat up his girlfriend, Nancy, I have to be honest with you. And she was just screaming.
I've been kidnapped by the Sex Pistols. Help!
Nancy Spungen of Philadelphia was found in the singer's suite at the Chelsea Hotel. He's been charged with second-degree murders.
I was dealing with a 21-year-old kid, you know, transplanted from the UK to the United States in a big problem.
I'm in mourning for Sid today.
A little while later, he went back to bed and then he died in his sleep.
Ini bukanlah berita biasa, namun benar-benar kisah nyata. Kehidupan menyedihkan sekaligus kehidupan kelam sang rocker muda tampan. Rocker punk fenomenal dalam hubungan aneh dengan ibunya juga pacarnya. Sehingga akhir hidup mereka semua berujung sangat tragis. Yang akan kita kupas lebih dalam lagi dalam tayangan dokumenter Cast K Channel. Selengkapnya sesaat lagi hanya di YouTube K Channel. Membuka jendela dunia. Itu adalah wawancara Sid Vicious setelah tuduhan berat terhadapnya, yakni membunuh kekasih yang sangat dicintainya, Nancy Spungen, wanita yang dibenci oleh tim band Sex Pistols dan sebagian besar penggemar beratnya di Inggris dan Amerika Serikat. Dan setelah kematian Nancy, kisah tragis pun berlanjut dalam kehidupan Sid Vicious beserta kisah tragis ibunya. Sid Vicious, bintang rocker muda tampan yang kontroversial sekaligus fenomenal sebagai subkultur punk, memiliki nama asli John Simon Ritchie. Lahir pada 10 Mei 1957 di London, Tenggara, Inggris. Ia lahir dari pasangan John Ritchie dan Anne Ritchie. Ayahnya adalah seorang penjaga di Istana Buckingham dan seorang pemain trombon semi-profesional di dunia musik jazz London. Sementara ibunya, Anne, adalah gadis putus sekolah. Ketika John Simon lahir, mereka sekeluarga pindah ke Ibiza, Spanyol. Tetapi saat John Simon berusia 2 tahun, ayahnya meninggalkan John dan ibunya begitu saja. Ayahnya tidak pernah muncul lagi dan tidak pernah memberikan lagi dukungan keuangan, sehingga John Simon dan ibunya benar-benar hidup dalam kesulitan. Mereka benar-benar hidup terpuruk, hidup dalam kemiskinan. Sehingga Anne terpaksa menjual marijuana demi untuk bertahan hidup. Kemudian dengan bantuan kedutaan besar Inggris di Spanyol, akhirnya Anne dan putranya bisa kembali pulang ke Inggris. Dan Anne bisa menyekolahkan putranya. Lalu pada tahun 1965, Anne menikah dengan Christopher Beverly. Dan pada saat ini, Anne resmi berganti nama menjadi Anne Beverly. Tetapi 6 bulan kemudian, suaminya meninggal karena gagal ginjal. Dan Ed kembali hidup hanya berdua dengan putranya, John Simon. Amy yang berjiwa bebas, sering tinggal berpindah-pindah dari satu tempat ke tempat lain, membawa serta putranya. Iya, ini adalah masa sulit bagi Anne sebagai ibu tunggal miskin yang harus merawat putranya tanpa memiliki tempat tinggal.
She was poor and she had a kid. So it wasn't even like she was a single working mother. It was just Sid and Anne, you know. And she was kind of a hippie or a beatnik, I suppose. Free spirit.
Dan Anne terpaksa melakukan apapun yang harus dia lakukan untuk bertahan hidup. Hingga suatu hari, Anne mendengar kabar baik baginya. Namun ia tak berpikir kabar baik menurutnya itu akan berakibat buruk pada dirinya dan masa depan putranya.
She heard a rumor from a friend of hers that if you were dependent or dependent, you could get a free flat, you could be moved up the housing list in like no time. So she just literally said she was dependent and she got this flat. Of course, the downside to that is you're living in a world surrounded by dependent people.
I visited his house where his mother lived. His mother was a dealer. It was quite clear she was always in the kitchen cooking up something or other.
Coke. The more things, the better, really. Anne's boyfriend selling Sid in front of me. And I thought, you know, that was it as far as I was concerned. It would have been a very obvious and regular sight to come home and find Mum flaked across two mattresses with a syringe in one arm.
In a home where there is a lot of open use, then this would become normal for that child.
Meskipun cara asuh Anne pada putranya John Simon sangat tidak biasa, namun hubungan Anne dengan John Simon sangat dekat. Anne sangat menyayangi putranya dengan caranya sendiri, hingga ia tidak mampu untuk mengatakan tidak pada putranya. Dan teman-temannya mengatakan itu merupakan bentuk kasih sayang Anne dengan caranya yang salah.
With Sid and Anne, it wasn't like mother and son. It was like they were partners in whatever crime, the hell they were creating, whatever it was. She was his friend more than his mother. She cared about him a lot and took care of him when she could, like a mother. But she was considered one of the gang.
Pada tahun 1973, saat John Simon sekolah di Kingsway, ia bertemu dengan teman sekolahnya bernama John Lydon. Sejak saat itu, mereka menjadi sahabat karib, beserta teman-teman lainnya yang juga bernama John, yakni John Gray dan John Wardle. Hingga orang-orang menyebut empat sahabat ini sebagai The Four Johns. John Simon Ritchie, namanya kini mulai berganti dengan panggilan Sid Vicious oleh sahabatnya John Lydon, setelah John Simon digigit oleh hamster peliharaan John Lydon yang bernama Vicious sebagai lelucon mereka. Tetapi mulai saat inilah John Simon Ritchie mulai dikenal dengan nama Sid Vicious. Selepas berhenti sekolah, keempat sahabat ini mulai banyak bergaul dan nongkrong di King's Road, Chelsea, London, yang pada saat itu merupakan epicentrum swinging London ketika musik dan mode sedang berkembang. Dan tempat favorit anak-anak muda Inggris saat itu adalah toko pakaian Malcolm McLaren dan Vivienne Westwood yang bernama SEX, dan menjadi pusat gaulnya anak-anak muda dari seluruh daerah di Inggris yang ramai berdatangan ke toko ini dan di jalanan seputar King's Road.
There were always these young kids coming in, they'd all come and hang around, and Sid was really just one of those. I mean, heard about the vibe of the shop and how sort of like trendy it was becoming. I always liked him, I have to say, and there was something warm about him. He was just very genuinely just a nice person. I mean, so yeah, he stuck around. I mean, I think he was probably stealing the clothes as much as anybody else was.
Area Kings Road ini pun menjadi pusat mode kaula muda yang sedang tren. Hingga banyak para fotografer berdatangan untuk memotret gaya penampilan mereka. Dan Sid Vicious menjadi pusat perhatian para fotografer. Karena selain ia bergaya fashion yang sedang tren saat itu, Sid juga memiliki wajah yang sangat tampan.
Just saw a kind of an aesthetic beauty in his face, which was really kind of breathtaking. He was one of those people when if you saw walking down the street, if you saw in a crowd, you know, he takes your breath away. You would gasp at the beauty, and he's, you know, you would say, you know, he burned your eyes. He was so beautiful.
I always thought he was handsome. I always thought he cut an amazing figure. He had the look. A lot of fashion people came in, photographers came in to sort of take snaps of all of us because we were the hip and happening youngsters at the time, and they would always gravitate towards Jordan or Sid Vicious.
He looked more like a sort of James Dean character. He had like slick back hair. Sid had this shy little boy, lost childlike quality, I think he had about him.
Sid yang dikenal sebagai pria pemalu yang berusia 19 tahun saat itu, selain berpenampilan punk, ia juga mulai tertarik pada kancah musik punk. Sehingga Sid dan Lydon sempat mengamen di sekitar jalan King's Road memainkan musik punknya, di mana banyak orang yang melintas memberikan uang receh pada mereka, tetapi hanya agar mereka berhenti memainkan musiknya. Pada tahun 1975, John Lydon bergabung dengan Jones, Dan Matlock, dan Paul Cook dalam formasi band Sex Pistols yang dimanajeri oleh Malcolm McLaren. Dan sejak terbentuknya band Sex Pistols ini, Sid menjadi penggemar berat band ini, di mana sahabat dekatnya John Lydon atau dengan nama panggung Johnny Rotten menjadi vokalisnya. Sid tidak pernah melewatkan satu kali pun setiap pertunjukan band Sex Pistols. Sementara Sid, pada tahun 1976, ia bergabung dengan grup band lainnya, di antaranya The Flowers of Romance sebagai vokalis, kemudian menjadi gitaris di grup band The Skids, dan sempat bermain drum bersama band Susie and the Banshees di 100 Club Punk, sebuah klub yang sering mengadakan pertunjukan musik rock dan festival punk rock. Tetapi Sid tetap sebagai penggemar fanatik band Sex Pistols, hingga ia pernah menyerang seorang kritikus rock dengan rantai sepeda, hanya karena kritikus itu telah memberikan sebuah tulisan buruk tentang band favoritnya. Ketika di awal pertunjukan band Sex Pistols yang masih belum ramai penontonnya, bahkan belum ada yang menangkapinya sama sekali, Sid lalu muncul ke tengah lantai dan mulai bergoyang dengan melompat-lompat mengiringi lantunan musik punk yang dimainkan oleh Sex Pistols sebagai rasa penghargaan Sid pada permainan musik band favoritnya. Dan kemudian, aksi tarian lompat ala Sid ini menjadi tren di kalangan penikmat musik punk rock yang kemudian dikenal sebagai Pogo.
The first time I met Sid, it was a Halloween party. And this guy, he was gorgeous. He looked different to everybody else because it was about 1974. And this guy had like slick back hair and a leather jacket. I was just totally mesmerized. I was like, fascinated. I thought, who is this guy?
My first real memory of Sid is the Pistol played a place called Bang's Disco. But at that point, it was like a gay disco. They played the first set and there was absolutely no response from anybody. I mean, there was barely anybody there anyway. And Sid came bounding up after the first set, but that's really where you get the origin of the pogo.
He had a gift for provocation. He did invent that strange kind of dance that became known as the pogo.
Sejak saat itu, orang-orang mulai banyak menonton band Sex Pistols dan mulai mengikuti cara tarian ala Sid yang mulai anarki. Ya, Sid menciptakan merek anarkinya sendiri di dunia punk dan berhasil menyita banyak perhatian, yang pada akhirnya telah membuat Sid mendapatkan pekerjaan impiannya. Pada Februari 1977, manajer band Sex Pistols, Malcolm McLaren, mengumumkan bahwa Glenn Matlock telah dikeluarkan dari band dan digantikan oleh Sid Vicious sebagai pemain bass. Walau Sid tidak mempunyai pengalaman bermain bass, hanya belajar sekali, tetapi manajer Sex Pistols menilai bahwa Sid adalah sosok yang sempurna untuk band Sex Pistols. karena ia memiliki wajah yang sangat tampan. Banyak gadis-gadis yang menyukainya. Ia juga memiliki gaya dan sikap yang disukai pecinta punk. Dan mengenai permainan bassnya, ia bisa terus berlatih dan cukup cerdas untuk dapat berlatih dengan cepat.
And he said, "Do you want to play bass on the Sex Pistols?" And on the fact that I'm good looking and I have a good figure and girls like me.
Sid was one of these extraordinary people.
Sid Vicious, yang awalnya hanya penggemar berat band Sex Pistols, kini ia menjadi salah satu personil dalam band tersebut. Itu adalah impian dalam hidupnya. Dan keputusan Malcolm McLaren untuk memilih Sid ternyata tidak salah. Semenjak Sid bergabung dalam band Sex Pistols, nama band ini semakin melejit. Sid menjadi daya tarik utama band ini, hingga para penggemar Sex Pistols semakin meluas dan membludak. Tidak hanya gadis-gadis, para lelaki muda juga begitu mengidolakan Sid Vicious. Dalam beberapa bulan saja Sid bergabung dengan Sex Pistols, ia kini menjadi bintang melebihi dari vokalisnya. Hingga di setiap pertunjukan Sex Pistols, para penonton ramai bergeser ke sebelah kiri hanya karena ingin lebih dekat dengan Sid. Gaya berpakaian punk ala Sid dan gaya rambut Sid kini menjadi trend di kalangan anak-anak muda Inggris yang mengikuti gayanya. Mereka semua demam Sid Vicious.
Sid was the most perfect choice to move into that apartment. I suppose he really couldn't play anything. But hey, listen, didn't matter, did it? It was all about the image. Becoming a Sex Pistol, I mean, it's probably a dream come true in a way. Now, from being their number one fan, he was now in the band.
There was no question you couldn't take your eyes off him. He shone so much more brightly than anyone else. When he ever boarded the stage, the audience would always squeeze themselves all over to the left side, because all they wanted to do was be as close as possible to Sid. And Sid would spend sometimes half the show constantly talking to them.
Walau aksi panggungnya nampak selalu diwarnai anarkis, dan sempat ada aksi panggung berdarah yang paling dikenal, ketika Sid terlibat insiden yang membuat sebagian wajahnya berdarah dan menetes pada tubuhnya, Sid tetap bermain bass dengan sangat baik dan bersemangat di atas panggung tanpa membersihkannya dulu.
I just remember at one point him sitting on the bar and he was just covered in blood. I think he just broken the bottle and he just started slashing himself.
I used to sort of like put cigarettes on my arm and watch them burn down, and I used to slash that open. You know, I used to rip coke cans in half to get the jagged edge so you could get a real nice cut and stuff. And I'd never seen Sid doing any of that until he'd seen me doing it.
Whenever we play, there would seem to be some kind of altercation going on. It seemed to be Sid trying to get a bit of the limelight for himself. And it seemed to me he had this kind of slightly masochistic quality about him that he'd like to start a fight.
People in the audience would look at him horrified, what kind of person would do this? And their response feeds his sense of self as being different, as being special. He's focused his energies and his efforts on creating an identity, one which doesn't seem to be true to who he perhaps really was. He's trapped by this, because in the end it's what people want to see. They don't want to see who you really are.
Tetapi Sid tetap menjadi bintang rocker punk fenomenal yang selalu dibanjiri penggemarnya. Hingga terdapat produk-produk merchandise seperti t-shirt dan boneka Sid Vicious yang dijual di toko-toko dan sangat diminati, khususnya bagi penggemarnya yang sebagian besar anak-anak muda, termasuk anak-anak kecil yang juga mengidolakannya. Sehingga Sid disebut sebagai icon punk. Ya, John Simon Ritchie yang pemalu kini telah mengubah dirinya menjadi Sid Vicious, sang icon punk.
Sid was one of those guys, you could see it right from the beginning, he was destined for disaster.
When I was 12, I was just a kid. When I was 13 to 15, I was a skinhead. From 15 to 20, I've been a punk.
He's very awkward around women and girls.
he wasn't comfortable. He probably was most comfortable amongst a couple of lads, you know, like Lydon and John Wardle. He was probably most comfortable in that setting. But, I mean, he hung out with me all the time, but it was always a little bit awkward and stiff between us, even though we were together every day. You know, he was sweet, but he was very sort of innocent in many ways, and he would never try it on.
As a young person who's not allowed to have sex or finds it difficult to approach other people to have sex for the intensity of love and sex, it is much easier to get an intensity of feeling by being violent to either yourself or to other people. This to me is typical of Sid. So he is hurting himself, covered with welts and burns, to get the kind of intensity of feeling. I do know that he absolutely was desperate for attention. Children who are brutalized as children kind of cope with that by anesthetizing their senses. And so to have any feelings at all, those feelings tend to be extreme.
Sid was complete marshmallow, really. You know, he's like, we were like playing with children and playing games. And he loved all of that. And like, and he was a big softie.
He was just like a normal guy. I mean, you know, very funny. People never realised he had a great sense of humour. What you saw on stage and what you read about in the newspapers was not the Sid that really was in truth.
I always describe him as a lovable bozo. Up until he became a pistol, he was he had a sort of dopey sense of humour, which was fun. It was fun to be around.
Namun seiring dengan perkembangan punk, banyak orang yang menentang dan menganggap punk sebagai ancaman terhadap fondasi peradaban. Hingga di Inggris, punk dinyatakan anarkis yang memicu aksi demo besar-besaran di jalanan. Band Sex Pistols berada di garis depan gerakan. Dan faktanya, perkembangan punk tidak dapat terbendung lagi.
Gay guys there, yes, there were a few sort of like lesbians, yes, there was some it was this whole mix, but that was London at the time. I mean, you know, this is what was going on. Everyone was young, we were all doing really strange things.
It was very outrageous for that time. I mean, we really pissed a lot of people off just because of the way we looked.
We weren't the nice boys they thought we were. We aren't nice boys. We were and we still are.
Tetapi pada tahun 1977, ketika Sid bertemu seorang gadis groupie dari Amerika Serikat, band Sex Pistols menjadi berubah dan kehidupan Sid menjadi sangat tragis. Untuk sobat semua, sebelum lanjut ada baiknya untuk mengklik terlebih dahulu tombol like, share, dan subscribe, serta tombol notifikasinya agar tak ketinggalan update kisah nyata tak biasa dari K-Channel selanjutnya. Nancy Spungen, gadis yang kala itu berusia 20 tahun, adalah pecandu bubuk haram yang parah yang telah ia konsumsi sejak usia 14 tahun. Ia datang ke London dalam misinya untuk meniduri salah satu personil band Sex Pistols. Dan selama di Inggris, ia bekerja sambilan di klub malam sebagai penari tanpa busana. Dan sekaligus sebagai pemasok bubuk haram pada para musisi yang sebagian besar tampil di klub-klub seputaran jalan King's Road.
She was definitely after getting one of them. And from what I've heard is that she slept her way through maybe Steve. I think she Rotten wasn't interested in her.
She rolled and over to John and tried to f*** him. And I think he wasn't cooperative. And so she rolled the other way and Sid was. And I think that was it, really. Sid lost his virginity to Nancy. As a second choice, I have to say. Sid was very immature, he was very insecure, and she was ideal for him, you know, because he was one saying that you're the star, and which, you know, when you're insecure, is what you need.
She was just like a loud,
horrible New York junkie, you know, and with everything that entails, the lies, the stealing.
I saw him on the Pistols boat trip. It was Nancy Spudgeon, who I didn't like one little bit. She looked really, really dirty, little scruffy tart. But love is blind.
That bitch, that slap, why the hell didn't she f*** off? She was a hooker. She was the worst possible influence for Sid. And then Sid would come and say, you know, oh, you know, she's great, she's really beautiful.
One might imagine that in that relationship, he was able to find acceptance of himself as a man, perhaps. And this would, of course, increase his level of attachment and devotion to her.
Dan akhirnya Sid dan Nancy menjadi pasangan kekasih yang tak bisa dipisahkan lagi. Tetapi hubungan Sid dan Nancy menjadi hubungan yang banyak dibenci semua orang, termasuk oleh manajer dan personil band Sex Pistols, karena Nancy dianggap gadis yang membawa pengaruh buruk pada Sid Vicious. Sejak Sid bersama Nancy, Sid menjadi pecandu bubuk haram yang sangat parah. Walau Sid telah terbiasa melihat ibunya selalu menggunakan suntikan, tetapi itu tidak membuatnya menjadi pecandu. Sid memang sempat mencobanya, namun hanya sebatas bereksperimen. Sid hanya banyak minum alkohol dan sesekali menggunakan obat-obat pil yang disalahgunakan. Dan Nancy lah orang pertama yang memberikan suntikan pada Sid. Dalam satu bulan, Sid benar-benar telah ketagihan. Ia menggunakannya setiap hari dan semakin parah saja. Dan Sid benar-benar sudah ketergantungan pada Nancy. Sid mengatakan pada semua bahwa Nancy adalah satu-satunya wanita yang dicintainya. Ia juga sempat mengatakan bahwa semua wanita harusnya seperti Nancy.
Yes, I'll make you a cup of coffee. Will you try and f***ing wake up, please? Will you fall asleep on your sunglasses? Wake the f*** up. Wake up, please. Just wake up.
Yeah, okay, I'll wake up.
Sid yang semakin parah serta hubungan yang tidak sehat antara Sid dan Nancy telah membuat geram tim Sex Pistols, terutama manajernya Malcolm McLaren. Ia berencana untuk memisahkan Nancy dari Sid, sekaligus membuat Sid berhenti dari suntikan yang membuatnya ketagihan. Lantas McLaren mengirim band ke Belanda dalam pertunjukan The Sex Pistols Tour tanpa ada kehadiran Nancy. Dan dalam tur ini, Sid benar-benar diawasi gerak-geriknya. Ia selalu dikawal, hingga pergi ke toilet pun ia tetap diawasi.
Well, it's always difficult to cope with people who are addicts, particularly if you're not. You don't have a lot of experience in that world. We would not allow him to go to the toilet without a roadie present. Boogie, another roadie, had to smash the door in, only to see Sid sitting on the toilet, saying, "You can't even have a shit in peace."
Setibanya kembali ke London, Inggris, Sid tetap kembali tinggal dengan Nancy, dan kembali mengkonsumsinya yang selalu dipasok oleh Nancy. Melihat hal itu, sang manajer kembali membuat rencana dengan menculiknya dan mengembalikan Nancy pulang ke Amerika Serikat. Tetapi rencananya tersebut menjadi gagal. Upaya McLaren pun menjadi sia-sia.
We beat up his girlfriend, Nancy, I have to be honest with you. Wrapped her up, threw her in the back of this car. And the roadie, the job was to drive her straight to Heathrow and put her on the first flight back to the US. She kind of managed to break open the back door of the car and roll out into the curb as a policeman came strolling by, and she was just screaming,
"I've been kidnapped by the Sex Pistols, help!"
He didn't like me because I was a he tried to keep me and Sid apart for months and months and months. And finally he just gave up because he couldn't do it. He just couldn't do it.
It was impossible to separate him from Nancy, so really I just threw my hands up.
Pada tahun 1978, band Sex Pistols memulai tur Amerika Serikat selama 2 minggu dan lagi-lagi tanpa Nancy. Pertunjukan turnya digelar di sejumlah daerah di Amerika Serikat seperti di Louisiana, Georgia, Tennessee, Texas, dan San Francisco. Tur Sex Pistols di Amerika Serikat tampak sukses dan selalu diburu oleh para awak media yang selalu mengikuti mereka. Kebanyakan penonton juga tampak puas melihat penampilannya, walaupun masih ada yang mencaci aksi panggung mereka.
There are 1980s an expression we need. Our first fashion expression for the 80s.
I think they're sickening and disgusting.
They were great. They were great. If I could only make out the words, they'd be greater.
He's very attractive in a really base way. And that really was very much part of how they were, all of them, had that kind of quality in slightly different ways.
Dan selama tur Amerika ini, sang manajer telah berhasil menjauhkan Sid dari Nancy. Dan berhasil membuat Sid tidak lagi terkena suntikan. Karena ketergantungan Sid telah digantikan oleh obat metadon. Tetapi rupanya sang manajer tidak berhasil untuk menenangkan ketegangan di internal band Sex Pistols. Hingga akhirnya, tur Amerika yang terbilang sukses ini pun berakhir dengan kepulangan kembali ke London, Inggris tanpa kabar baik bagi para penggemarnya. Karena band Sex Pistols bubar.
San Francisco, really, it was probably the best gig they did. It was the next day when they had a meeting, and Malcolm told John that he wasn't in the band anymore. To hear that John had been fired by Malcolm and Steve, just the weirdest and most improbable conclusion to the whole thing.
Dan Sid menjadi salah satu yang paling kecewa. Band yang sangat dicintainya dan pekerjaan impian dalam hidupnya ini kini tak ada lagi. Sid banyak minum, hingga ia sempat dirawat di rumah sakit di New York menjelang kepulangannya kembali ke Inggris. Setibanya di London, Sid dan Nancy pun kembali bersama, sekaligus membuka lembaran baru Sid dalam karir solonya, di mana Nancy mengumumkan bahwa ia kini menjadi manajer Sid dan menjadi kabar yang mengejutkan.
I'm Sid's manager and I know.
Setelah Sid dan Nancy bersenang-senang di Paris sekaligus merampungkan film dokumenter The Sex Pistols, mereka kembali ke London. Sid mulai kembali tampil dalam pertunjukan di atas panggung. Bersama salah satu mantan personil The Sex Pistols, Glenn Matlock, dengan band barunya, termasuk drummer dari band The Damned. Tetapi kali ini, Sid Vicious tidak lagi bermain bass. Ia menjadi vokalis utama. Nancy ikut serta menjadi vokal latarnya, namun Glenn Matlock memastikan mikrofonnya tidak terpasang saat konser berlangsung.
Sid was a fantastic singer. He had a real presence, he had a great voice.
Sid, you're gonna be a big star in this state.
It was probably like about $7,000-$9,000 in your pocket every night. So not bad.
Sebagai pasangan yang tak bisa terpisahkan lagi, Sid dan Nancy akhirnya memutuskan pindah ke New York dan tinggal di kamar nomor 100 Hotel Chelsea sebagai rumah mereka. Di sini Sid dan Nancy mengisi hari-hari mereka dengan suntikan seperti biasanya dan berkeliaran di klub-klub punk Manhattan. Tetapi 48 hari setelah mereka pindah ke New York, Sid mengalami mimpi buruk yang nyata. Dalam peristiwa tragis yang membuat kehidupan Sid benar-benar berantakan. Pada tanggal 11 Oktober 1978, Sid dan Nancy mengadakan pesta di kamar hotelnya malam itu. Tidak hanya menggunakan suntikan, tetapi dua jenis obat tablet lainnya yang ia salah gunakan secara bersamaan. Dan keesokan harinya, pada pukul 11 siang, Nancy ditemukan tak bernyawa di bawah wastafel kamar mandi dalam keadaan luka berat di perutnya. Ia terkena tikaman pisau belati Jaguar K11 yang dibeli Nancy beberapa hari sebelumnya sebagai hadiah untuk Sid. Dan pisau itu tergeletak di atas kasur dengan spray yang berlumuran darah tepat di sebelah Sid yang sedang terbaring tidur. Saat itu Sid benar-benar terkejut dan tampak bingung. Pasalnya ia tidak tahu apa yang terjadi pada kekasihnya Nancy, karena ia tidak mengingat apapun. Dan Sid juga tampak sangat hancur mengetahui Nancy telah tiada. Sid begitu stres. Apakah ia sendiri yang telah melakukannya tanpa sadar?
Sid was like, you know, out of it. And then the next thing he woke up, when Nancy's dead on the bed with the flick knife, and he knew nothing about it.
He may very well have been completely obliterated. He may even been unconscious at different points based on the amount of he ingested. Not just there was two and all and other things that had been used and abused.
When I first met Sid with Nancy at Revenge, they seemed happy. And then over the course of the next 6 weeks or so, you could see that he was not doing well.
Setelah para petugas dari kepolisian New York datang ke TKP, berita ini pun serentak menjadi berita besar yang sangat menggemparkan, yang ditayangkan di berbagai surat kabar dan berita televisi di Amerika Serikat dan Inggris. Tak hanya para awak media yang berdatangan ke Hotel Chelsea, tetapi termasuk para penggemarnya. Mereka merasa berkabung, namun sebagian besar dari mereka tidak merasa kasihan pada Nancy yang telah terbunuh, melainkan mereka kasihan pada Sid Vicious, karena Nancy wanita pembawa pengaruh buruk pada Sid, hingga Nancy banyak dibenci dan Nancy yang membuat peristiwa tragis itu terjadi.
Room was very bloody. There was blood on the sheets and blood on the mattress. There was tracks of blood leading into the bathroom where the body of the female was found lying under the sink. She was stabbed in the stomach.
Yesterday, police found him there in room 100. And on the bathroom floor, they found the 20-year-old American girl he'd lived with for 2 years. Sid Vicious reportedly admitted he'd stabbed Nancy Laura Spungen to death. And no one who knew him could believe it.
But he really loved this person. He felt that Nancy was the most, was the woman of the world. He felt that women should be like Nancy. And he loved her more than he loved his music.
He was very quiet. He was a loner. They were sensitive people, and they seemed to get along very well. In fact, they were always holding one another in my office, so you sort of sensed that there was a great affection between them.
I couldn't believe it. I couldn't believe it.
Fans showed up, saying they are in mourning, but not for the 20-year-old girl Vicious allegedly killed.
I'm in mourning for Sid today.
Really?
Really. I really feel sorry for him more than for the girl.
Sid merasa bersalah atas apa yang mungkin telah dilakukannya dan mengalami depresi berat. Ibunya Sid, Anne Beverly, dan manajer Sex Pistols, Malcolm McLaren, yang sangat menyayangi Sid, mulai sangat khawatir. Mereka berdua meminta psikiater forensik Dr. Steve untuk menilai keadaan pikirannya. Dr. Steve menyarankan agar McLaren dan ibunya menjaga Sid di bawah pengawasan.
I recommended that they watch him, that one of the two people with him watch him all the time.
Tetapi mereka tidak melakukannya.
And Sid had taken a light bulb from the toilet and had gashed his hands, you know. And his hands were sort of reaching out like this as we came through the door and they were dripping, both hands were just dripping with blood.
I got another call of that he had cut himself, but I'd come back over to the hotel. So I went back over there, and indeed, he had slashed his arm lengthwise from his wrist all the way down to his elbow area. And they had it compressed so the bleeding was contained. That wasn't in danger, but it was quite clear that he was now at a different level. It seemed he had a much longer depression going on from his childhood about kind of being treated second class by a society. He seemed to have no sense of purpose. The Sex Pistols had broken up and Nancy's death was overwhelming him. I mean, his coping strategy had been I think the cut wasn't a attempt. I've seen people, particularly in prison when I was working there, that cut themselves and The usual report is that they're in such pain they cut themselves essentially to let the pain out. And I think that was much more of what was going on there, but nonetheless it was dangerous.
Lalu ambulan dan polisi segera datang. Sid kemudian dibawa ke rumah sakit jiwa Belleville.
It was clear that Sid was not stable. Also, his mother seemed to be having problems. She was bruised. They'd obviously been in a fight together. She just couldn't look after him. But maybe nobody could at that point. I'm not sure.
And so we talked and decided that had to put him in the hospital and called emergency medical services to come over.
Dr. Steve sangat prihatin dengan keadaan pikiran Sid dan merekomendasikan agar Sid menerima perawatan psikiatri jangka panjang. Tapi itu tidak terjadi. Sid menolak untuk tinggal di sana. Surat kabar memberitakan bahwa Sid melakukannya karena ia ingin bergabung dengan kekasihnya, Nancy yang telah tiada, karena dirinya. Sid berulang kali memberikan wawancara pada Pearce tentang keinginannya untuk mengakhiri hidupnya. Persona Sid Vicious kini sedang diuji hingga batasnya dengan menghadapi tuduhan pembunuhan tingkat dua yang membuat hidupnya benar-benar lebih berantakan dari sebelumnya. Dan berita penangkapan Sid Vicious menjadi berita utama di semua media setiap harinya.
Sid Vicious, a British punk rocker, became famous by being well known. Certainly not for his music. Perhaps for his public obscenities, antisocial statements, and vulgarity.
Nancy Spungen of Philadelphia was found in the singer's suite at the Chelsea Hotel. He's been charged with second-degree murder.
It was just such a sad situation. I always knew he never murdered Nancy. I just knew it. I mean, there was just no way he would. So it had to be a terrible accident.
Pasca penangkapannya, Sid berada di penjara Rikers Island di seberang Manhattan, New York. Di sini ia benar-benar merasakan mimpi buruknya yang nyata. Selain ia mengalami depresi berat, ia harus menahan rasa sakitnya karena tak bisa menggunakan suntikannya lagi. Tetapi yang paling buruk, di sini ia mengalami serangan-serangan yang membuatnya merasa semakin hancur.
He apparently was raped. Was beaten up. Everything that is your worst nightmare that would happen to you in prison. I mean, how could anybody cope with that?
Pengacara Sid berjuang keras untuk membebaskan Sid dari penjara karena mereka yakin Sid tidak bersalah dan bahwa mungkin Nancy terbunuh oleh pengedar yang ingin mencuri uangnya.
I was dealing with a 21-year-old kid, you know, transplanted from the UK to the United States in a big problem. There were a number of other people who lived in the area, in the hotel, and who were supplying to these people who had opportunities and access to these people, and it was not unlikely that someone could have come in and attempted to assault them. We were very optimistic that the prosecution would not be in a position to prove beyond a reasonable doubt that he was responsible.
Sid was gonna get off, we all hoped. Bailey was gonna do an excellent job. His bill was gonna be astronomic. And Sid was going to play Las Vegas and pay for it. That was it. I had the money. It wasn't a question. I was not going to use it. I used it immediately.
Sid Vicious is in a detention cell at the Manhattan Criminal Court building, waiting for friends to post $50,000 bail. Vicious is charged with murdering his girlfriend yesterday, and today a Manhattan grand jury began hearing evidence in the case.
Dan akhirnya pada 1 Februari 1979, ia berhasil membebaskan Sid dengan uang jaminan sebesar 30 ribu pound sterling atau sekitar 40 ribu dolar.
He was certainly relieved to know he was being released. The last thing that I said to him was, I'll be in touch with you, just be careful.
Pada pukul 10 pagi, Sid dibebaskan. Tetapi ia tidak disambut oleh Malcolm McLaren yang telah mengatur dan membiayai pembebasan Sid sesuai yang diharapkan Sid yang butuh kehadiran McLaren untuk mendukungnya. Karena kala itu McLaren tengah berada di London. Ia dituntut oleh John Lydon karena telah mengendalikan band Sex Pistols. Saat Sid terbebas, ia hanya disambut ibunya, Anne, dan teman lamanya Peter Kudik, seorang fotografer. Setelah 55 hari tubuhnya bersih dari pemakaian bubuk yang telah membuatnya ketagihan selama ini, justru hal pertama yang ingin ia lakukan adalah memakainya lagi. Tetapi ibunya memberitahu surat kabar bahwa apa yang paling dinantikan Sid saat pembebasannya adalah memakan es krim yang banyak. Tetapi kenyataannya, Sid ingin menyuntiknya lagi yang dibelikan oleh ibunya sendiri.
He was released into the custody of his mother, who then what goes out and buys for her son. You know, it's unbelievable to me that would have happened.
One could see his mother supplying him with as an act of care. Perhaps she recognized the pain he was in psychologically and emotionally, and was doing what she could to take the pain away.
Often talk about their as their best friend, their lover.
Sid ingin segera tiba di hotel tempat ibunya menginap yang berada di beberapa blok dari gedung pengadilan.
Walking down the street is like, I think, you know, she kept saying, yeah, did you get it? Did you get it, Mom? Did you get it? Yeah. yes, Sid, you know. Okay. Walk, faster.
Sid dan ibunya bersama-sama menggunakan suntikan itu di kamar hotel tersebut. Dan itu merupakan tindakan cinta keibuan Anne yang sangat aneh pada putranya. Tetapi tampaknya Sid belum juga puas. Karena bubuk yang dibelikan oleh ibunya tersebut bukanlah bubuk yang menurutnya bagus. Hingga akhirnya, Sid meminta temannya Peter Kodik untuk membeli bubuk yang bermutu tinggi yang dibayarkan oleh ibunya. Meskipun Anne tampak bahagia memasok putranya dengan bubuk haram tersebut, tetapi ibunya bukanlah orang yang membuat Sid ketagihan. Melainkan, Sid berterima kasih karena ketagihannya itu berkat wanita lain dalam hidupnya, yaitu Nancy Spungen.
I said I'd see what I could do, and I'd see him later on that evening.
There was no frame. There were no goalposts. He never saw a red light. He only saw green. Danger wasn't something that he'd ever consider. And he never ever thought that his life was important.
Pada sore harinya, Sid dan ibunya memanggil taksi. Mereka pergi menuju Bank Street ke sebuah apartemen di Greenwich Village, New York. Di mana saat itu, Sid mengatur pesta khusus dengan teman-teman dekatnya untuk merayakan hari pertama kebebasannya. Apartemen itu milik Michelle Robinson, seorang aktris berusia 22 tahun. Michelle adalah wanita pertama yang berhubungan dekat setelah kematian Nancy dan sebelum Sid ditahan di Rikers Island. Di pesta saat itu juga ada Irene Polk, seorang fotografer yang juga teman dekat Sid, Nancy, dan juga dekat dengan ibunya Sid. Pada pukul 8 malam ketika Peter Kodik masih di jalanan mencari barang pesanan Sid, ibunya tengah memasak makanan favorit Sid, yakni spaghetti bolognese. Saat itu Sid dalam kondisi yang sangat baik sepanjang sore.
In treating depressed people that you always watch for, because if you see that their mood suddenly starts to get better, one of the things you have to be very suspicious of is that they haven't decided that they're really going to themselves, because their mood usually picks up when they do. They're no longer in confusion and in conflict.
Dan pada malam itu akhirnya Peter datang dan berhasil membawa apa yang telah sangat dinantikan oleh Sid sepanjang hari. Dan tanpa menunggu lama, Sid dan Peter segera masuk ke kamar. Sid sudah tak sabar lagi untuk segera memakainya. Tetapi Peter mengingatkan satu hal penting sebelum Sid mulai memakainya, bahwa Sid harus berhati-hati dalam menggunakan dosisnya. Karena barang yang dibawa Peter bermutu tinggi, terlebih lagi Sid yang sudah lama tidak memakainya, tentu akan berakibat fatal jika memakainya tidak sesuai dosis yang dianjurkan.
I said, you know, be a little bit careful because this is quite good stuff. So I knew it was quite strong that had been picked up.
In 55 days, he wouldn't have had any tolerance left, and he would have had to have started off at a low dose of. It's very common for people who have been addicted to go to jail If they're not careful on their first dose, they can die.
Selepas itu pemakainya, ia mulai bolak-balik pergi ke kamar mandi untuk muntah. Kemudian ia terjatuh dan tak sadarkan diri.
He was fine for, you know, 10-15 minutes, then I think, you know, he got up, he threw up, he went to the bathroom, threw up again. You know, Sid was throwing up, but she was used to that before. She'd probably seen Sid throw up a million times before.
My first thought was, oh, he's fallen asleep or something, but then I realized right away that he was a he started turning blue, and it was pretty scary.
Semua orang begitu cemas. Semua berusaha membangunkan Sid dengan bermacam cara.
If somebody takes he can manifest the effects of sleeping, of having fluid get in his lungs, even have froth coming out of his mouth. And acts to depress the brain function, they can't breathe right.
Dan akhirnya Peter berhasil membuat Sid tersadar. Dan hal pertama yang Sid ucapkan adalah
and the first thing he said when he came out of it was I'm sorry I scared you all.
Dan pesta mereka pun telah usai. Semua teman-temannya sekitar pukul 2 malam berpamitan pulang termasuk Peter Kurik. Tetapi sebelum pulang Peter menitip pesan pada ibunya Sid.
What there was left I gave to his mother and I said look as far as Sid knows there's no left, okay, it's all gone. Give him this in the morning. She's like, fine, fine, yeah. She said, you promised Beverly, you promised you won't do this. Yes, yes, I promise. At about 2 o'clock, he was fine.
Peter merasa tenang bahwa Sid akan baik-baik saja. Dan Peter adalah salah satu orang terakhir yang melihat Sid Vicious masih hidup. Karena keesokan harinya, Sid ditemukan sudah tak bernyawa di tempat tidur di samping kekasih barunya, Michelle Robinson. Sentak saja berita kematian Sid Vicious menjadi berita menggemparkan. Apartemen Michelle Robinson di Greenwich Village ramai dikepung oleh para pencari berita.
Vicious' nude body was found today by his mother and a girlfriend in a Greenwich Village apartment one day after he was released from jail. He died of what's described as an accidental type illness.
Sid Vicious will not have to stand trial for the murder of a girlfriend at the Chelsea Hotel. Sid is no longer vicious, he's dead. His nude body found in a Greenwich Village apartment, spoon and syringe nearby. The dose may have been accidental.
Vicious shot up some and he had a reaction to it, which he came out of about 45 minutes later. And then about 2 o'clock he laid down to go to sleep.
All they know for now is that he had been asleep with companion Michelle Robinson at the time of his death. She's an unemployed actress.
The head injected about midnight. He had a reaction at that point. Right. A little while later, he went back to bed and then he died in his sleep.
Did you know that Vicious was staying here?
Yeah, I did.
Can you give us any insight as to how he had been acting recently?
I don't believe this going on.
The significance of detoxification is that if a drug user is detoxified and uses the same dose he was used to, it can be lethal. And so the detoxification program takes the drug user off the drug, but it also removes whatever tolerance or immunity he has to the drugs.
Sid Vicious, the punk rock star, dead from an The dead man's mother had discovered the body at noon today when she went to awaken him in the bedroom of his girlfriend, Michelle Robinson. Miss Robinson, asleep at the time, was not aware that her boyfriend had died during the night.
John Simon Ritchie, a.k.a. Sid Vicious, had a 1 p.m. appointment with Homicide to talk about the murder charges against him in the killing of his girlfriend, Nancy Spungen. 1 hour earlier, he was found dead in bed.
Penyebab kematian Sid dipastikan karena dosis yang berlebihan. Yang diyakini itu memang sengaja dilakukan oleh Sid yang ingin mengakhiri hidupnya karena rasa bersalahnya yang menyebabkan wanita yang paling dicintainya telah tiada, Nancy. Anne Beverly, ibunya Sid Vicious, mengatakan bahwa ia menemukan surat di saku jaket kulitnya dengan tulisan tangan yang mengatakan, aku menemukan fakta kematian dan harus menepati janjinya. Tolong kuburkan aku di samping makam kekasihku dengan jaket kulit, jeans, dan sepatu butku. Dan menurut ibunya Nancy Spungen, yaitu Deborah Spungen, seorang penulis buku yang mengangkat kisah tentang putrinya, Nancy. Deborah mengatakan bahwa Sid telah menulis surat kepadanya saat terakhir kali Sid dirawat di rumah sakit. Isi surat itu berbunyi, "Kami sangat ingin mati bersama dalam pelukan satu sama lain. Aku berjanji kepada kekasihku bahwa aku akan mengakhiri hidupku jika sesuatu terjadi pada Nancy. Dan Nancy juga berjanji hal yang sama padaku. Ini adalah komitmen terakhirku untuk cintaku."
After we did that show, we had a sort of farewell drink one lunchtime in my local. And he said to me, he said, "I'll be dead by the time I'm 21. And I said, "Get out of it."
I was really, really sad when Sid died. I mean, it really affected me badly. And, you know, he was a good guy with an intelligent brain.
Because the person I knew, I didn't think he'd be capable of doing something like that. If he hadn't met Nancy, I think he would probably still be alive today. History would be completely rewritten.
If I regret anything, I regret not having been there.
Sid was a child, you know, he never grew up. And never really had the chance to.
Tetapi permintaan Sid yang ingin dimakamkan di samping makam kekasihnya Nancy tidak bisa terwujud. Karena Nancy adalah seorang Yahudi dan ia dimakamkan di pemakaman Yahudi di Pennsylvania, di mana penguburan antar agama tidak memungkinkan untuk dilakukan. Jenazah Sid dikremasi di Garden State Crematory di New Jersey dan dikabarkan Abu Sid Vicious ditebarkan di atas makam Nancy Spungen oleh Ibu Sid and Beverly yang diantar oleh saudaranya dan dua teman Sid. Kematian Sid Vicious menjadi berita utama media internasional selama berhari-hari, sekaligus menjadi misteri dan perbincangan hangat, di mana sebagian orang yakin bahwa kematian Sid bukanlah secara disengaja oleh Sid untuk mengakhiri hidupnya, tetapi Sid telah dibunuh. Karena terdapat kejanggalan, dari mana Sid mendapatkan bubuk haram itu? Hingga ia menggunakannya lagi dengan dosis yang cukup untuk mengakhiri hidup dua orang sekaligus. Karena menurut Peter Kodik, malam itu Sid tidak tahu bahwa barang itu masih tersisa. Akhirnya Sersan Richard Houseman yang menyelidiki kematian Sid mengungkapkan fakta yang sebenarnya dari sebuah rahasia yang tertutup selama 27 tahun. Sebelum ibu Sid meninggal karena overdosis pada tahun 1996, ia mengungkapkan kejadian sebenarnya di malam kematian Sid Vicious.
She reapplied the tourniquet, and she filled the syringe, and she re-injected him. She knew exactly what to put inside that syringe, that basically would have been enough to kill two people.
Pada malam itu, saat Sid berdua dengan Michelle di tempat tidur, Sid memujuk Michelle untuk ikut memakainya. Tetapi Michelle menolaknya, karena ia tidak bisa menggunakannya. Ia juga tidak mau melakukannya. Tetapi Sid terus memaksanya, hingga Michelle tak mampu lagi bagaimana cara mengatasinya. Lalu Michelle segera meninggalkan kamar. Lalu ibunya Sid, Anne, meminta Michelle menunggu di luar kamar, sementara ibunya berbicara empat mata dengan putranya Sid di dalam kamar dengan pintu terkunci. Dan di dalam kamar ini, ibunya sengaja menyuntikannya sendiri pada putranya dengan dosis yang luar biasa yang cukup untuk mengakhiri hidup dua orang sekaligus. Ibunya sengaja melakukan itu sebagai tindakan rasa kasih sayangnya dan rasa kasihan serta ketakutan bahwa putranya nanti akan kembali mendekap di penjara Rikers Island. Hingga Anne menangani masalahnya sendiri pada putranya dengan tangannya sendiri. Michelle Robinson yang berada di luar kamar memudahkan Anne untuk melakukannya karena tidak ada saksi hingga pihak berwenang tidak dapat menuntutnya. kehidupan sang ikon punk Sid Vicious banyak dikenang dan dituangkan dalam sejumlah buku, diangkat dalam sejumlah film dokumenter, film layar lebar, lagu-lagu dengan judul dan lirik tentang Sid Vicious, serta pameran foto-foto Sid Vicious yang digelar oleh sejumlah fotografer yang telah memotret Sid Vicious semasa hidupnya sebagai ikon punk.
I hope he leaves a brilliant legacy. Sid was a style icon. You know, if you log on to things these days, kids are more likely to log on to Sid than they are to Johnny.
I think he left this legacy of punk.
Well, the fact that he's become the icon for that particular era, and the fact he's one of the few who've actually got their own little, you know, dolls and merchandising aspects to it, I think really is.
Dan berikut sejumlah referensi dalam dokumenter kisah nyata K-Channel kali ini.